Welcome everybody to the first ever episode of the dialogue between Guru Yogi Shivan and Meenadhi Pandya. So for this season, we're going to be talking about decoding all of our Indian mythology and rituals. You know, as our whole generation, I have been very curious about how do I study this mythology and make it applicable to my life? How do I understand my rituals and give them more meaning? As a person who's curious about scriptures, curious about the purpose of life, and as a mother who's passing on these rituals to my children, I have always been very curious and I cannot wait to get this season started. We're going to do this season by season, taking topics of interest one at a time. By the end of 4 seasons, I promise you, you will have a deeper understanding of yourself, of life, and of everything that ancient Indian wisdom has to offer more than ever before. So with that, I'm going to pin our comment for today. And we are going to get started decoding Indian I am so glad. I know we've all waited for this eagerly, including me. And I am so happy that we could get this again started. I wanted to organize and bring something to you where we can have a flow and have a pattern and we can learn in a more organized manner. I will tell you that the last year, the whole year of dialogue with Guru Yogi Shivan has really been life-changing for me. Very grounding, has made me look at the world in a different light. And to do this in a more organized fashion is... So let me see if Guruji is here. I'm sure Guruji is going to be here in no time. And also, Namaste Krishnaji. Namaste everybody. Namaste Rajni. Everybody, put your questions in. I may not be... Because we're going to do Bhagavad Gita in 3 parts. We're going to take questions, but I'm going to try and weave in your questions. I'll be reading your questions. I may not take them all today, but I will be weaving them in and creating a flow so that we can build it up. In the 3rd session of the Bhagavad Gita, we will take more questions and we will have a proper time dedicated to Q&A. But in the meantime, bring it on. Ask me your questions. Keep it going. Join me as we do this. So we're going to get Guruji on. Let me see if he's here. And he's still not here. So in the meantime, I'm going to share my little story with Bhagavad Gita. When I was about 19 or 20 and I started reading the Bhagavad Gita with Swami Chinmayananji, I found my notes recently where I had studied chapter by chapter and written a pressy about what I understood from the Bhagavad Gita as well as how I can apply it to my life. Now when I go back and I look at it, Prasadji, I will add you. But Prasadji, I can't see, you know, I'll go live. Okay. Prasadji, have I been able to go live with you?
Hey, the sound over again.
Prasadji?
Hello.
How are you? Hi, Prasadji. Namaste. I'm well. How are you?
I'm good, Nidhiji. How are you?
I'm very, very well. Is Guruji going to be joining us from your window?
No, I don't know. I mean, I'm not in intimacy right now.
Guruji must have sent me an independent request. Prasadji, I'm going to have to take you off camera and add Guruji on.
No problem. Please.
Thank you, Prasadji. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
So I think, Prasadji, you're going to have to leave the live for a moment. Yeah. So, you know, I think beginning, we are still going to adjust to the glitches and we will become seamless. Patience always pays off. It has always paid me off. Hi, Tripti. Good to see you here. I know you've eagerly waited for this. So I was sharing about my journey with Bhagavad Gita. And after each chapter, I found myself writing how I could apply it to the problems that I faced back then. Of course, when I read those little problems, they seem very silly now. But what I do realize is that how much of who I am and have become actually comes from that experience. So, I cannot wait to recreate that experience. And I would suggest for everybody that at the end of this, to kind of go back and review how you can take this and use this in your own life. So Guruji is on, and without further ado, let's get this started. Thank you, Mitali. Guruji, namaste.
Namaste. How are
So,
you?
I am good and so excited that we can start this again, Guruji. Have been eagerly waiting and really feel blessed so that we can start the dialogue between you and me. I'm just going to see, I think the comment is not pinned, but the title is on here. So anybody who's confused about what we're talking about can look at the title. And we are decoding the Bhagavad Gita today. So how have you been, Guruji?
Perfect. Everything is going on very well.
So Guruji, before we even get into Bhagavad Gita, I want to ask you, when did you first become curious about the Bhagavad Gita? When did you first get your hands on the Gita?
Actually, when I was in Oman, it was in 1992.
1992. So you must have been very young, Guruji. 30 years old, I'm
Yes.
guessing.
No, that time I was 24.
24
24
years
or
old.
25.
24
Yes.
or 25. And that's the first time that you got your hands on the Bhagavad Gita. So,
Because
Guruji,
I was a very busy karate master. And all of a sudden I got some physical problems developed. Not only physical problems, then when I faced, come across with people from different parts of the world who were having very high appreciation about Indian tradition and the yogic philosophy. There I was teaching traditional martial art like Kalaripayattu and all these things. So when I was forced to give answers for serious question regarding the essence of Indian traditional martial art, I came to know it was derived from yoga. Up to that moment, I was just focusing only on the peripheral level of martial art, how to defeat an opponent. But when I was forced to give answers for serious questions, then I came to know that actually the real fight is happening within the self. The fight between our ignorance and our consciousness. So consciousness say that I know everything, I can handle everything, but our inner self is saying that, hey guy, you know nothing. So there is a big clash. There, I wanted to know the real fight, the meaning of the wars between our like Deva and Asura. Any traditional book you take from Indian tradition, in front of Vishnu, gods and demons are fighting each other. And if you see Devi Mahatmyam, the Parashakti, Supreme Goddess, is manifesting as different faces, like Kali, Bhairavi, Sri Lakshmi, many what we can say manifestations are there, and she was completely engaged in fighting with the demons. So why? The gods are really fighting with the negatives. Then we are taught that gods created or God created everything. Then why did God created a demon and fighting each other? That was my question. Then later I came to know that it is our own positive and negative thoughts, symbolized as God and good and evil, or God and demon. So I wanted to know the essence of Kalaripayattu. So I am not supposed to defeat an external enemy. I am supposed to defeat my own ignorance. There I became so keen on the unconditional approach of spiritualism. I didn't want to fall into a belief. I wanted to rely on myself. There, I wanted the pure science. There, I took Gita as my first attempt. It was fantastic. That gave me good guidance. Again, Gita itself is not a book or a scripture to depend on. It's only a guidance. There, I took the book as my guidance.
Great. For those who don't know, Guruji growing up always been a high achiever in everything that he did, whether it was culinary, other martial arts, tennis. In fact, he was always high achieving, very focused in whatever he did, very sharp in whatever he did. He says he was mischievous, and then he went to Oman and he looked at the world in the worldly sense because he was always achieving, achieving, achieving. And when he went to Oman, he had an ailment. And at that point, the ailment became an opportunity for Guruji because he began to question that what is this life? Like, why? What is the meaning of this if I have to take a medication my whole life? Also, Guruji was questioned apparently because he was teaching Kalaripayattu, which is an ancient martial arts. And when he looked deeper into it, he realized it has come from Yoga Shastra. And in Kalaripayattu, you're not really, even though you're physically fighting with an external person, you actually are fighting with your own ignorance. So this is how Guruji's path led him to the Bhagavad Gita. So with that, Guruji, with that, let's do a starting question. If you had to introduce the Bhagavad Gita to somebody, if somebody didn't know what Bhagavad Gita is and you had to introduce it, what would you say it is?
The first one we have to understand is Gita. Gita is a devotional song in Sanskrit.
Yeah.
What is divine? Whatever we don't know, we make it divine. Whatever is beyond our reach, we make it divine. So, who is the creator of this world? Or who created me? If I am very open and unconditional, why I am born? There is no answer. I am a consequence of the pleasure of my parents. That much only my brain can understand. But is it true? I don't think so. So I don't know why I am born and how I am, and why I am surviving like this. And many things are, whatever I see in front of me, are contradictory. I don't want a bald head, but it's not in my hand. At the age of 15, 20, 25, I had thick hair. And I was thinking that, I was very handsome. But day by day, it started falling off. Okay, I didn't want to fight against that. I didn't want to take any medicine. But it was not my will. And I started getting wrinkled. I don't like it, but it's happened. I don't want to beat my heart 72 times a minute, but I have no control over that. So each and everything is happening with some kind of instruction from nature. That is not my will. And one day I know I will die. But what is after death? So these are the questions which we don't know. Our intellect cannot understand. So once we don't know about something, we make it divine. Oh, that's a divine fact. So there Gidam starts. What is beyond our comprehension? There is something which is incomprehensible. So people wanted to go to that level of consciousness or that dimension, and they experienced something. They explained it through divine language, which is called Gita. So Bhagavad Gita is, Bhagavad means Bhagavan, God. God Himself is delivering to you the essence of your life in a systematic, rhythmic order. That is what is called Bhagavad Gita. So
Beautiful.
it's a science, or it is the reality of your own existence. If we see the sloka which is recited as a prayer, Om पार्थाय प्रतिबोधिता, पार्थाय प्रतिबोधिता भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथिता पुराण मुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम्। What does it mean? Parthan. Who is Parthan?
अर्जुन
It is taught or it is explained to us as a complication or a despondency of a very powerful warrior. His name was Parthan. But in essence, Partha means our prana. What make you aware that you are alive? Because you are breathing. You have a life, sign of life. That is what's called prana. When prana is left, oh, people say, oh, he has gone or she has gone. So that prana is having artha. Artha means meaning. So you have, as Nidhi, you have your own meaning. You have your own ego. This is what everybody is a part. Prana is manifesting as our own existence, our own personality. Pratibodhita, to convince him about the reality. So the natural or the secret of the nature or our own creation is being taught or delivered by whom? Purana Muni. Muni means the person who could understand or who could go beyond the senses. So Bhagavad Gita is a collection of shlokas or verses which is explaining about the incomprehensible. Yes.
Very nicely explained, Guruji. How Guruji said, right? Anything as human beings, we know the biology, the technical understanding of biology. This is how we were born. And then when we are born and we start looking at the world around us, there's so much that we cannot comprehend. So much we realize is not free will. So much we say is just happening. And we say every time we don't understand what's happening, we think it's a divine force. It's mystical. We can't explain it. And we begin to question because undesirable things also happen. We begin to question our own identity. And that's what Partha is, that the combination of the breath and the self, which gives us life, right? Is this ego, who am I, combined with your breath. And then you have a, you know, at a subtle level, that's what gives us this identity, which is not just the pleasure that our parents had. It's not just the fact that a man and a woman united. It's beyond that. And all of those questions then kind of get put away as divine. So the Bhagavad Gita is essentially, Gita means song. And the Bhagavad Gita, the Bhagavat means God, Bhagwan. So it is, what are all of those questions that surround a partha, surround a person who has this identity and breath and who's confused about his existence? The Bhagavad Gita answers all of those questions. Am I right, Guruji? Okay, lovely. So Guruji, what is the reason for the Bhagavad Gita to be encapsulated in the Mahabharata? Is it just so that we have these characters and we have a whole context? For the Bhagavad Gita has come out of the Mahabharata. So why is it like that? And why that becomes the most important part? I've always been curious.
See, all our teachings, our traditional teachings are leading to the incomprehensible. Because comprehensible things we can accurate from anywhere, because they are within the limit of our senses. We have, our existence is a combination of tangible and intangible. Then, you know, things which can be understood through the senses and thing which is beyond the senses. The sukshma and sthula, like energy and matter. Our existence is a combination of energy and matter. Now we know, everybody, that we have a mind. But where is the mind? Nobody can explain it. The mind is manifesting through matter. So this gross and subtle combine each other to give us our existence. All our traditional teachings are, or yogic science, is focusing on the incomprehensible reality. Here, The seeker is guided to go beyond the senses. For that, they adopted a technology. First, they started bringing the attention of the senses. For that, they used some symbols. Then, through the symbols, they injected the philosophy behind this incomprehension, or the science behind the incomprehension. Then it is guided that you can transform yourself into that reality. So everything is having three levels. As a boy, I was sitting on the lap of my father, and I used to listen the stories of Mahabharata, Ramayana, Devi Bhagavata, Srimad Bhagavata. Like a child, it was narrated very well. So Bhishma, who was unbeatable, invincible, even God couldn't stop him. So when I heard about him, I wanted to be like Bhishma, because nobody can defeat me. And Bhima came, so he can even take an elephant and throw. So that much strength was there. Arjuna was ready to, capable of even stopping the rain by sending the arrows. He was as fast as that. So these things were really giving a complete attraction towards the science as a boy. So I was so curious to know what is next, what is next. So in that level also we can, masters were successful to infuse the energy or the respect, or we can say the sublimity was installed in a boy. That is the first section. Then as I grew up, I was a bit reluctant to fall into these kind of beliefs. Oh, these are all exaggerated stories. But I didn't want to give up the love and care of my father. So that was my sentimental attachment to the stories. Then, because of that sentiments to my father and attachment, I started thinking why my father taught these things. Then I came to know that these things are symbols of a reality. Bhishma is the symbol of morality. See, he faced a lot of situations, very, very complicated situations, but he was not losing his identity. Many temptations came, criticism came, troubles came, but he was standing like a rock or a mountain in front of the wind. So I felt that, yes, this much quality should be there. We should have, certain morals. We should
character.
Maintain like character, like Krishna. And he was not ready to compromise with any one of his benefits. So it's good. Then Bhima. Bhima is the representation of the son of air, God air. That is the Vayu in the body. Arjuna was the sharp shooter, the guy who has got one-pointedness. If you want to succeed in your life, you must have the ultimate, extreme concentration. So all these characters were holding or containing wonderful messages for a successful life. To develop our character, improve our personality, these things were working like that. So as a young guy, I appreciated the effort of our masters. Then I came face to face with the bitter realities of nature. Like old age started, when my body started perishing, I came to know that all my dreams, all my expectations are going to perish. There is no consistency in my life. That there I understood. And I came to know that I am going to be defeated forever, because old age started catching me. There I saw Mahabharata, Ramayana are talking about what is beyond the mortality. There is a technique which is installed in all these stories, the technique of the essence of Upanishad, Shrunandu Vishwe, Amritasya Putra. Hey, children, why are you crying? Your existing world is Maya. Beyond the Maya, there is a reality. If you are capable, come on, achieve it. You can be inspired by yourself. There, the third layer, Krishna, was talking to Arjuna. Later, Arjuna and Krishna became one. There, the duality, matter and energy, or the gross and subtle, vanishes, and the third reality, evolves. That is the ultimate freedom, the experience of truth. There, the seeker is transforming himself into the seen. This is what. So these three layers are there in each and every teachings of Indian tradition. So Mahabharata is Bha means Bhanam. Bhanam in Sanskrit, the unmodified state of energy. Ra means their energy manifests. So in the passive energy, then active energy, parashakti, touches each other. Rajas means activity starts. Tam means tvam. So Bharatam means you don't know the passive energy of your existence, but you know the active energy of your personality. Then understand this both, then you will come to know who you are. Tat tvam asi, you are that, thou art that. So here, that's why Bhagavad Gita says, you start with a clash, Mahabharata Yuddha, the war between Pandavas and Kauravas. They are our positive and negative thoughts, and they are getting into a clash. That is the fight against the seeker and the secret. Then, finally, what's happening? The seeker will be transforming himself into
United.
something which is beyond explanation.
Lovely.
Here, Gita should be taken as your own life. The Mahabharatam is your own life, your body, your mind, your thoughts, your life. And this is your own responsibility. It means every individual's responsibility to conquer our ignorance and go beyond our limitations. Understand the unlimited reality. You are what you know. If you know the reality, you are the infinite. That is what is called Aham Brahma. This is the essence.
Great, great Guruji. I'm going to summarize it. So, as children and as anybody, in the modern world, when we start looking at Mahabharata, of course, it's very exciting. And the way our scriptures were written is that when we are in the sensory world, we are so engaged with our senses. So, when we read the Mahabharata, that it will draw our attention. It will draw all kinds of feelings come up, feelings of love, of hate, of jealousy, of anger, of pride. That's all encompassed. And as a child, who's living in the sensory world, because that's what children do, this is very exciting and it holds your attention and it was designed to hold your attention. And then we become a little older and then we naturally start questioning everything. And then we start questioning that, oh my God, why am I studying all of this violence? These are all really crazy stories. And that's what happens. And that happens to probably all of us. And then we really start questioning the meaning of life and, all the incomprehensible that we understand. So through the Mahabharata, we're going through all of this whole sensory journey of enjoying the world and then questioning the world. And at that point, when we start questioning the world and we start seeing there is so much that is incomprehensible, we can dismiss it as divine that you cannot understand the divine secret, or we can become true seekers and say we want to understand this divine. And we want to unite with this divine. And that's where the Bhagavad Gita comes in. So it starts with the setting of the Mahabharata. It takes us through everything, the ups and the downs and the lows and the highs. And then after that, when we really start to question and seek, and that dialogue, right, which is essentially the Bhagavad Gita, the dialogue between the seeker and the secret, between Arjun and Krishna, and at the end of it, kind of really disclosing that reality, giving us that experience of that what is not Maya, of that which is eternal, of that where we come from, that became the Bhagavad Gita. So now we've been able to put the Bhagavad Gita in context. The name Mahabharata really means that, that active, that passive energy that is there in all of us, and it's active manifestation. And how, as the energy changes, the manifestation changes, and that's what continues to happen throughout our life, depending on where we are in our energetic sphere. So Guruji, I think one thing that's very important is this, that we should, let's talk about. So you spoke about Bhishma, you spoke about Arjun, you spoke about what Krishna symbolized, but in the most simple manner, and we can take the rest of the session today to do this. We can even continue it. So it's going to be a three-part session on Bhagavad Gita. If we need more, we will do more sessions. But Guruji, as we get into the plot of the incomprehensible of the conversation, and this comes from one of the previous lives that you and I had on death, when we started talking about what does this cast of characters mean, what does the Pandavas mean, the five Pandavas, and how and the 100 Kauravas. So Guruji, can we understand the cast of characters really briefly, so we understand, you know, what all of this symbolizes, just the main characters of the Gita, and then we come to the main essence of the incomprehensible.
Actually, there is no importance for any one of these characters
Okay.
because all these characters are our own thoughts,
Right.
or the part of our behavior.
Right.
See, while there is a sound coming, you know, like something is jerking or beating. Are you getting some? I mean, it's
Is
only for
anybody
me,
else
or
getting
where are
it?
you?
Is anybody else getting any disturbance? Let's wait and see the answers, Guruji. Because earlier, when you had said about you had said how the Pandavas represent the five, oh, is it my earrings that are, oh, there is a sound. They think
Something
it's my
is there
earrings. I'm
banging.
going to take them off. I'm going to take them off if they are dangling too much. Or maybe it's the mic. I think it's the mic that may be dangling.
Don't know really.
Okay, I'm going to take off the headphones. Is it better now, Guruji?
Now it's okay.
Okay. I guess I was the only one who couldn't hear the sound, but we're good now, Guruji. There is no headphones, and then there is no earrings. Nikita has even no.
Okay, so
Of my earrings and everything.
the audio is okay now?
I think so. I think so. I think
Oh, fine.
it's great now. I think the volume is great. Okay.
So,
So,
please.
Guruji, remember we had spoken at some point about the cast of the characters, where we had said that how the Kauravas represent the 100 vices we have, and how the Pandu represent the five Mahabhoots and the five potentials that we have. So just that level of understanding, so we understand what is this battle against.
Okay. First, we can go through Krishna.
Yes.
So he is the key character. I mean, the embodiment of Lord Narayana. This is the way it is announced or taught. What is the meaning of word Krishna? Karshyade anena iti Krishna. Krishna means what is attracting everything towards its center of gravity is called Krishna. So that means we all are Krishnas. If you take an atom, there is a nucleus. That nucleus is holding the atom as it is. If somebody comes and pull my hand now, it is not going to be, taken out. But after my death, maybe after 48 to 72 hours later, if somebody comes and pull my hand, it will be, taken out. Correct? Why? Because the Krishna, the energy which was holding each and every cell in my body towards my center, has gone. So that the magnetic force is not there. So that is what is called Krishna in our life. The higher or the real consciousness of our existence. The second one is the main character we can see, Dhritarashtra.
Guruji,
The more.
can we elaborate on Krishna a little bit more? I think I have personally missed some of it. So Krishna is a higher potential, but the example that you used of dispersion, can you repeat that a little bit more, Guruji? Can we elaborate on that?
Yes, the word meaning of Krishna is the magnetic force or the force which is holding something as a product or a matter. For me, I have a center of gravity, as I say, I. Who am I? I don't know. But I always say, I am so and so. Actually, everybody is in that search of finding who am I. That is what is called Krishna. So the energy, any object or any molecule you take, one drop of water you pour from a glass, immediately you can say it will take an oval shape. That means it has got a center of gravity. That gravity or that force is called Krishna. Okay? So Krishna is the main character in Mahabharata. Mahabharata is our life, centralized on Krishna. Then the next powerful character is Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra is very powerful but blind.
So Dhritarashtra is the father. For those who don't know the cast of characters, Dhritarashtra is a blind father, king of 100 sons. He has 100 sons
Yes,
and he's blind. And
that.
now Guruji will explain. So because Guruji, not all the audience knows who Dhritarashtra is. So while Krishna is an advisor, he's like this advisor to all the royal families and a friend. Dhritarashtra is the king, the blind king with 100 sons. Now Guruji will explain who he is.
I think we should have a session to tell about the essence of Mahabharata, or at least
Absolutely.
we should introduce the characters.
Yes, that's
And
exactly what we are doing now. Yes,
yes,
Guruji,
so a
that's
summary
exactly.
should be given to the summary should be given to the listeners, then they can understand what Gita is.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, it will be a little difficult. Anyhow,
Absolutely.
Dhritarashtra is the father of 100 sons. They are they're representing the negative energy in our or negative thoughts in our existence. And who is Dhritarashtra? Dhritarashtra is our own ego. Because we have very powerful ego, but we know very well that our third eye, the spiritual eye, is blocked. We are spiritually blind, materially strong. This is the representation.
Oh wow. That's why Dhritarashtra was blind.
Yes. So Dhritarashtra represents our strong ego. We are not ready to give up because we are attached to our sensory possessions. Even scriptures, gurus, even God comes and say that, "Hey, you are doing something wrong. Give up that." But our ego says, "No, I'm not ready to give up." So Dhritarashtra is the representation of that strong ego. And his children are powerful negative thoughts. What is the other side? Five guys, Pandava. They are the manifestation of five, actually four gods. First one, Dharmaputra. Dharmaputra is the son of the god of death, Dharmadeva, god of death. That is the representation. Dharayade idi dharma. He knows in his deep level, he knows that even though I have my body, but there is something beyond the mind as the law of Mother Nature. So he represents the cosmic law. Second one is Bhima. Bhima is the son of God Air, Vayu Bhagavan. So he is the representation of our life energy. Our prana is making us really alive. The other one is representing our mind. Mind should be focused. That is Arjuna, son of Indra. Indra is the god of enjoyments. the god, I mean king of gods. So Arjuna is very powerful and focused. Our mind is very powerful, and it should be focused. Then the Nakula and Sahadeva, they both are the children of Ashwini Deva, the divine doctors.
Yes.
Okay, so these are the, I mean, that knowledge is necessary for us for our maintenance. Body, mind should be maintained through medical knowledge. So these five are representing our reality of existence. They are less in number but very powerful. Others are negative, attached to sensory possessions and enjoyments, but they are come out, they already came out, come out from the blind father. So our ego created negative thoughts, our reality in our existence producing positive thoughts. But negative and positive, left and right brain, both will keep on fighting. That fight is the symbol of our life. If the fight is stopped, they merge each other, means death or liberation.
Amazing, amazing, amazing. So, what is great for everybody who's listening is born out of the same mother, the same place, are two brothers, Dhritarashtra and Pandu. Dhritarashtra represents the ego. And what comes out of ego, 100 things are born, 100 negative vices are born, all coming from ego. And the meaning of ego is thinking that this is reality, your third eye is shut, the knowing of the eternity, the knowing of what, that sense of aham brahmasmi is missing. And you think this is reality. And with that third eye shut, Dhritarashtra was blind. And from that blind ego comes these 100 vices. And what is the, and yet, that's in spite of that ego, and we think we're so powerful, we get unsettled inside. And that unsettled is because all those 100 vices and the ego are kind of fighting with this questioning, which is represented of the truth by the five Pandav. And in the five Pandavs, they're five brothers. They kind of correspond to the elements, but they're basically sons of gods as well. And the oldest one, Yudhishthira or Dharmaputra, is the god of death, that kind of dissolution of our identity with back to the cosmos and restarting the cycle. Bhima was the second son and very powerful, is like Vayu, air, which is the initiator of everything, which can get things started. Arjuna was the third, the archer,
Mind.
the ace shooter. And he represents that focus that you require, that fire that you require to be engaging in the world. And Nakula and Sahadeva were the sons of the Ashwini twins, which are also the god of Ayurveda, which kind of deal with the physical, with the earth and the water, which the gross reality. So they're represented, so they're representations of that. And those are only five in number, but they are really our reality. And this is what we are made up of. And this reality gets in battle, starts questioning the ego and the 100 vices, the 100 negative thoughts that come out of ego.
Yes. So
Okay, great.
that is why in the end of the war, these 100 brothers will be killed. These five will be alive. Then the five will go for Mahaprasthana, means finally they will walk towards the Himalayas and they will dissolve themselves into nature. So what does it mean? Our negative thoughts will tie us, hold us in the material possessions, and if we become self-aware, we can defeat our negative thoughts and upgrade, uplift our positive thoughts, stick on that, live on that to a comfortable span of time. Then, by will, we can leave the body and dissolve ourselves into the reality. That is what is called Mahaprasad. If death comes as a compulsion, it's a painful death. If we accept or handle death consciously. That is what is called liberation. There are two methods, ways of death, Suryana and Chandrayana, or Urdhayana or Adhoyana. Means, so you should learn how to eliminate or control your negative thoughts and be conscious about the law of nature through five elements. Then you can have a free, comfortable, exuberant life. Then when you feel that this is enough, when death comes, you will face that situation gracefully. That is what is called liberation. So death is not happening compulsively. You will do it, or you will accept it or handle it consciously. That is the word meaning of Mahabharata. Mahabharata starts with a war. I mean, of course, there are many, many things we can discuss. Then after the war, then they will go for the Mahaprasthana. That is the message for each and every individual. Now, when you are strong enough, understand the message behind it and do the daily practice and come out of the ignorance.
Great. Great. So Guruji has kind of summed this up as a great starting point, created the setup for us that how this whole fight is between our good and the bad. They both come from the same mother. They come from the same source and they reside within us. And we've understood some of the characters before. We are going to be dwelling into more of the nitty-gritties of the Bhagavad Gita. But before that, it was important to have a little background on the characters. And, you know, Guruji, some more characters that are required to really create the setup that when did the war begin? You know, what happened? And, you know, how the vasanas came together and the war began. But before that, Guruji, can we talk about who Bhishma is and what does that signify in all of this? Can we talk about Krishna? Can we talk about Gandhari and Kunti? Just can we bring in these characters as well and what they represent? Because Guruji, otherwise the curiosity is going to left be unanswered. And you know me, I'll keep asking questions till I till I can't get these answers.
Okay. Bhishma. Bhishma is the ultimate answer for the fear of death.
But how is he related in the plot, Guruji? First, let's give his role in this plot in the Mahabharata. He was the uncle.
He was not the uncle. He was called Bhishma Pitamaha. So the real, what can you say, dynasty starts with him.
Yes, okay.
His father was Shantanu. Shantanu was having only one son. That was Bhishma. Okay, then from Bhishma, the whole
lineage,
you know,
began.
Dynasty.
Right, okay, got it, Guruji. Yeah.
So, who is Bhishma? That is the first question.
Right.
One day, Shantanu Maharaja was strolling on the banks of Ganga.
Right.
Then he saw a very beautiful lady. Then the first sight, he fell in love with her. So, he asked her to get married. Then she said, okay, I will marry you, but with two conditions. You should not inquire about my history, from where I am and who I am. And you should not deny any of my decisions. So Chandanu was carried away with the beauty and everything. And he said, whatever you say, I accept. So they got married.
Mm-hmm.
Then after 1 year, he got the first child. It was a boy. So Chandanu was very happy to see the first son, but without saying anything. Then the lady, the queen, took the baby and threw him in river Ganga and killed it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it happened. So because of his, you know, pledge, because of the understanding between these two people, the agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Shantanu was not ready to deny her action.
Mm-hmm.
So it is repeated, like seven children were killed like this.
Mm-hmm.
Then finally, this queen gave birth of the eighth son.
Mm-hmm.
Same story was supposed to happen. She took the baby to throw. Then Shantanu said, I'm sorry, you are the, what we can say, the cruel lady whom I have ever seen in my life. So she said, I cannot accept your brutality. I need my sangha. Then Tune said, see, I am goddess Ganga and I am here for a particular reason. Now, nothing is happening without a cause behind. That is a cause and effect theory. It's a long explanation. Anyhow, so now we have to go back to the story. There is a hidden story behind. Then that time, Goddess Ganga revealed that I am the Goddess Ganga coming from heaven and I have a mission. You know the story. Again, the eighth son was Bhishma. He was really protected from death by Shantanu. Then he lived for six generations. That is the real Bhishma and the invincible, the most knowledgeable and most experienced. So everything, a person, if you are a person or a man, all qualities of Bhishma you really dream for. But he is the most cursed one. That is the story. What I'm saying, the story is happening in heaven. Ashtavasu. Ashtavasu means there are eight gods who are doing, I mean, controlling eight angles of the universe. They're called Ashtavasu, eight divine energy sources. And one day after the duty, they were just roaming here and there. They saw the Vasishta, sage Vasishta's ashram. There was a divine cow, Nandini. So one of the Vasus, I mean, eight Vasus' wife, Prabhasa's wife, wanted to get this cup. So what happened? Even though they are respite of the godly qualities, they forgot everything and they went and stole the cup. So when Sage Vasishtha came back, he came to know that his cow was stolen. He became very angry. He said, now you did this heinous job. That means you don't know the quality of being a god. So you better go to earth, have a human life. 120 years you live in earth and learn how to improve yourself and how to be a god. So he cursed these eight people. Then the moment they came to know that they were cursed, their practical mind evoked. Then they fell on the feet and asked for, they apologized for their mistake. Then Guru said, see, once I gave the curse, I cannot take it back, but I can compromise. So you go to Mother Goddess, I mean Ganga, and ask your requirements. And if she can go to Earth and as a human body and deliver you, then as you born, immediately you will be killed. Then you will be liberated. You can come back to
Back here,
heaven.
heaven.
But Prabhasa, the guy who did the heinous job, he should not be relieved from the curse. So he should be, suffering, or he should be spending a whole life, a human life on earth. And that was the most cursed was Bhishma.
Bhishma. And what does
So
this
as a part
represent,
of
Guruji? What does this represent? I mean, what is the meaning behind this story? Like, why is it just as a starting point they have introduced this story?
Okay, now I will come back to our plane of life. If a newborn baby is dying, is it a bad luck or a good luck?
It's bad luck for the parents, Guruji.
Is it?
They've
They,
just spent 9 months
of
in
course.
desire of having this child, and now the child comes and just leaves the earth. But maybe for the baby it's not, I don't know, but for the parents it is.
Yes, we don't know. Their master is saying this. You are trying. You are having the misery because you don't know what is behind the manifested body. That is the message or the message of the story.
Got it, got it, got it. We think that this is a reality that I have done, and this is an action taken to kill the baby. But it was already preordained. So that is the
Yes,
message.
so all births are happening as an extension of a
Something in the cosmos.
pre-organized plan.
Something in the
So
cosmos.
nobody can prevent. So if the according to this story, death is a boon, because we are not being miserable in this existing world. There is something beyond this manifested world. But here, Bhishma, whom people think that he is the most powerful, most successful, and he was ruling the whole dynasty. In six generations, he was very powerful, but the most cursed person. So, being in this material world, showing our success is good or bad. Now, the question is unanswered, whether the died ones are lucky or the lived one is lucky. This is the question.
Oh. Wow, got it, Guruji. Yeah, you're living, you have some karma, you have to figure yourself out. Till we cannot have that enlightened death, we'll keep doing this. And when you can have the enlightened, not the compulsive death, the enlightened death.
Yes, that is what is happening. So Bhishma is not having a compulsive death. See the intricacy of the story. It is so subtle. If you want to understand the thread, which is going through all these characters, which will lead to you immortality. So even though Bhishma was cursed, so he survived over there because of his action. He got the boon from his father as Swachhanda Mrityu. Because of your actions, you are being benefited. You are granted that. So that is why he was lying on arrows. He was waiting for the best time for death. He was capable of deciding the time of his, death. When he has to leave the body, that was his decision. It was a conscious death, not a compulsive death. So even if we are cursed and supposed to be on earth a whole span of life, through your actions, your karmas, you can achieve the capability of immortality. That is the symbol of Vishnu.
And that is actually what the purpose of life is, because we all come, we can call it a curse, but we all come for this whole reason, because we are entangled in all of this. And then given the battle we have within us between the Pandav and the Kaurav that we all have existing, we can really come and have our Mahaprasthan. And once we look beyond the sensory world and we learn the truth, and that's what this conversation is going to be about.
But again, the message is whether the dead one or the lived one, both are having equal chance. That
Chance.
is the message. So no need to cry on, who already died, or no need to be very, what we say, proud on the living one. Both are equal, because we don't know what is happening in the cosmic plan. Our
Yes.
limited understanding, our comprehensive mind is not capable of understanding the law of nature or the secret of life. So our purpose of life is to understand that. When you understand the purpose, the secret of your life, you are liberated. Ultimately, the whole science, whether it is Purana or Mahabharata, Ramayana, whatever it is, they are leading to this ultimate destination, liberation or immortality, or transform ourselves into the ultimate truth.
Guruji, today's session has been amazing. I feel like we can have this conversation for my lifetime, my entire lifetime. I can have this conversation. Next time, Guruji, we will pick up again with the cast of characters. And because through it, you're already giving us the stories. And then we will go into what happens on the battlefield after we have discussed the cast of characters. So today we talked about the how from one place came the Kauravas and the Pandav. With the blind ego, they were born, with the Dhritarashtra's blind ego, there came about 100 negative vices. From Pandu came the five potentials that we carry. and we talked about that battle. Then we went to Bhishma's story. And next time we'll start again with Bhishma. We'll go on to Duryodhan, Krishna, Draupadi. We'll create the whole setup, and then we'll get into what happens on the battlefield.
Okay. Yes.
Great, great, Guruji. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Everybody revisit this, get familiar with the characters again and what it means for us in our life so that we can get even more out of the next session.
Yes.
Pranam,
Okay.
Guruji. Thank you
Thank
so
you.
much. So
Thank
much.
you all.
Thank you, Guruji.
Bye.